You name it. Good evening. Good evening. Thank you for tuning in to Black Coffee, No Sugar, No Cream. I am Valerie Bonner, and thank you for tuning in to 88.1. I have in the studio with me today, We the People's Grower Association, Community Garden from Ypsilanti, and that would be my guest, Jasper Gary. And we have Noah Rucker from Park Ridge Community Gardens. And we have Melvin Parson, also from We the People. So, before we get into the show today, I just want to pay homage to my dad. My father transitioned yesterday, and I'm all right. I would be better if people would stop bugging me about what his final wishes were and me honoring them, but I can handle that too. You know, but I'm happy to be in the studio today with three strong black men that love their community and that care about the community, because that's what my father was about, love. Yeah. My father loved everybody, and he cared about everybody. So I did not know my father was going to transition and not be with us today. But what better show to have to be in the studio with three men that care about if we eat? Because that's what my father cared about. He cared about if his family was fed and that we ate. So this is a perfect segue to go in. So let's start with Mr. Melvin Parson. Introduce yourself to our listeners and tell them a little bit about what you do and your association.
Well, first of all, thanks for having us here this evening. And where should I look? Should I be... Looking right here. Mm-hmm. Hi, everyone. My name is Melvin Parson, and I am the, I don't know what I am. I'm a lot of things, but I am the owner of a farming initiative. Talking to them. Okay, thanks. I am the owner of a farming initiative called We the People Growers Association, and that in Washington County, that's where I'm located, specifically in Ypsilanti, Michigan. And I don't know how I stumbled into farming and being a farmer. It just kind of fell in my lap beginning in 2014. And now I've somehow gotten to the point where I'm leasing about a half acre of land, and we're growing food on that land and employing men and women returning home from incarceration.
That's
and
awesome.
A lot of that food winds up in about 12 restaurants in Ann Arbor and 4 restaurants in Ypsilanti, and I've got the audacity to want to build a world-class urban farm that can support economic development within the community and jobs for returning citizens and some educational and training program for some at-risk youth students.
That is amazing, because I have some aspects of what I do that are very amicable towards returning citizens. So I salute you, brother, for the urban farming concept, but to then employ returning citizens and give them the opportunity. And also, it's extraordinary for you to now grow the food and have it in 12 restaurants, the food that you're growing. Are you at liberty to say? Can you name a couple of them?
Sure. So we primarily grow what's called brassica plants. And those are your leafy green vegetables such as collard greens, kale, Swiss chard. We also are working on growing hybrid tomatoes. We have a couple of culinary herbs such as thyme, oregano, and curly leaf parsley. We also grow quite a bit of jalapeno peppers.
Okay.
And Carmen peppers as well.
Okay, so do you send them to what restaurants, like sandwich places or things of that nature?
Wow. So I'll preface this with, I'll just name a few, because if I try to name all,
I don't want you to name them all. Yeah, I should have told you before. Right? Just one or two, like that we probably know, because you know, by people, if it's sure. like Zingerman's, you know, then people will know that the produce that's going on their sandwich came from a black farmer.
Sure.
You know, that's like part of being in business for yourself, right? So Zingerman's Deli takes your produce and uses it on their sandwiches. That is awesome. I'm going to say that again. Zingerman's Deli takes produce from Mr. Melvin Parson and uses it on the sandwiches that they serve. Thank you so much for that.
You're welcome.
Mr. Noah Worker, tell me about Park Ridge Community Garden, and Melvin kind of set the precedence for us. So how did you get into urban farming on the south side of Ypsilanti? And tell me a little bit about that and where your vision is. How do you see this growing and where are you going?
Yes, indeed. Peace. Thank you for having me here. It's most definitely awesome to be here. With Park Ridge Community Garden, we have been most definitely honored to get our essence into growing and cultivating food. So this year we have a plan to expand more with youth groups and getting them into more of a practice that they haven't been exposed to in their environment, trying to change the minds. And we have a activity that we're putting together with the book club. So with the holiday I created with Booker T. Washington Holiday, we're going to fuse those groups of children and write about their experiences, and so they can create their own books and get them into an economic background as well. And so that's what health economics is about. So we will work with the health and the economics at the same time. So it's about changing the environment.
Yes.
So that's what we're doing at Park Ridge Community Garden.
Thank you so much for that. Park Ridge has been around for a long time. I know Anthony Williamson, and I salute him for everything that he has done for economic development and everything on the south side of Ypsilanti, like bringing that Wayne County Community College program over there, and all Anthony has done. That brother is really about the community.
Yes, he is.
I've known him for many years, and I salute that brother for everything that he is doing over there. Jasper, it is your time to reflect. So I know that you and Noah are a team over at Park Ridge.
Correct.
Is that how that works? So what would you like to add to this conversation about the Park Ridge Community Garden, your role? What inspired you to become involved?
First of all, I wouldn't be in gardening at all if it wasn't for Melvin. Him working with the returning citizens is what rekindled my energy and my passion in the community gardening. So following in his footsteps is pretty much what got me involved with Brother Noah at Frog Island, which is where I believe we met. Mm-hmm. And then we partnered up with Melvin over at Park Ridge. And it's just been going steady from there. We've all been developing and expanding on our own projects, but it's one page in the same book.
I love that. One page in the same book. I really, really respect that, because it doesn't matter how we get there. Just keep our eye on the end goal. What is our intent, right? And so I can see you guys kind of have different perspectives, but the goal is the same and the intent is the same. And so that makes a true collaboration right there. So I appreciate that. For me, when I first heard about urban farming, it wasn't a very positive thing in my mind. I'm like, we having gardens in the middle of the neighborhood? Like, what is that? Are we bringing a plantation back? What we picking? You know, or whatever. But then as I saw it develop a whole lot more on the north end of Detroit is where I experienced it. One of my mentors drove me through there and was like, you know, look, instead of blighted homes and abandoned properties or whatever, they're torn them down. And it wasn't, I'm thinking I'm gonna see big cornfield or whatever, but it was really nice. It was like a serene garden, benches where people could actually sit. Okay, so you saw Baby Boy and like how his mom would go in the backyard, even though she was in South Central LA, but she had this serene place in her yard.
Beautiful.
Where she would go sit. And that's what I saw. So it changed my whole perspective. Yes. Of course, when we hear something, we think in our mind, you know, we envision something in our mind. But when I actually saw where people could really sit there and have this serene environment and pick their own food, feed their families, would never be hungry. And that's something that I appreciate getting back to. So when we come back from break, I want to know more about your growing associations and what they're currently doing in the community. I know that you tapped into some of it of what you're doing, but let's dive a little bit deeper into that after this break.
Thank you.
thank you for tuning in to Black Coffee, No Sugar, No Cream, Straight Talk with Valerie. And today we are talking to community gardeners, brothers who are making sure that we eat. So they have a community garden on the south side of Ypsilanti, Park Ridge Community Garden. And then Mr. Parson, he takes the produce from that garden and gives it to, well, has a relationship with several restaurants. So again, if you go to Zingerman's Deli, this is just one of them, you are getting fresh produce grown by him on your sandwiches. So that's really cool. We talked about your growing, your community gardens, your desire for growing, how you kind of got into it. Let's talk about how we can inspire more people to get into growing their own food, or at least being participatory with you and what you're doing. So let's start out with Mr. Parson. Can you tell me how you can inspire people to get back into that? Because I remember growing up with my grandmother, we used to go out to where Blocks is in Romulus. It's a huge produce market. But if you keep going down the road, they had a You Pick place. So when I was a little girl, and it's still there. So from knee high, I was out there eating. So I ate dirt and worms and everything else, because as a kid, I wasn't trying to wash nothing off. When we went to pick strawberries, I was eating more than I was really picking. Sure. But I would go out there with my mom and pick those things and come back. Yes, I can make strawberry preserves. I can make pear preserves. I know how to pick greens and blanch them and freeze them. I know how to make vegetable soup and can it. And you hear all the lids on the cans popping in the middle of the night as they're sealing. So I know about all of that stuff. So can you tell me how you can inspire people to get back into community gardening? What do you think it would take to inspire people to go back to that, or at least participate with you and what you're doing?
Great question. As I was thinking about that while you were mentioning all these things, these experiences you had as a child, I thought, reflected back on my childhood, and mine was the polar opposite of that. I remember, so I was raised by my grandparents, and we had a neighbor who, and my grandparents were from the South, and so was the gentleman and his family that were our next door neighbors. I think a lot of our folks during the time that my grandparents and folks like my neighbor came up north, they came for a couple of reasons. One was for the automation that was taking place up here up north, and they were trying to flee from terrorism in the South, lynchings and beatings and oppression and voter suppression, you name it, right? But anyway, so we had this neighbor, and I remember him in his backyard. He had these funny-looking vegetables that were growing, and I come to find out years later that they were collard greens, right? But, you know, my first response to that was, why is he growing these weird-looking things? He should have some grass right here, right? You know, so that was my being disconnected from the land and all of those food experiences. I think one of the things that we bring to the various things we're doing in the community is that we look like the community, right?
Okay.
And so it's easier for someone to see themselves being like someone if that someone looks like them.
Yes.
Right.
I kind of get that, especially for the young people. I remember when I was a scientist and I would go into the classroom to do things with the children. And the first question I would ask them is, what does a scientist look like?
Right.
And they would say, he's a white man with white hair, you know, or whatever. And I would be like, no, I'm one.
Right.
You know, he looks like me.
Right.
Or he or she looks like me. And so the kids were very astounded by that. So I appreciate that. So what I heard is taking that rich history of gardening and farming, etc., that we all have in our background, right, and bringing that into a modern day setting and just showing the importance. And by you loving what you do, that exudes, that energy exudes. I can tell that when I met you guys and when you came in. So Noah, I know how passionate you are, and Noah's just so supportive. When we did Survivor Speaks at the community center,
yeah,
Noah came and supported us. It was a primarily a female-driven event, but Noah was there. Noah is very supportive of the community, and I remember he gave his word. When we were there just talking about the event, he gave his word, like, I'll be back. So I know you have a heart for people. You have a heart for community. I know that you are an inspiration in your community, and I know that people really respect you and what you're doing. So Melvin talked about his influence, that what drove him to get into farming, and of course by him giving jobs and opportunities for to returning citizens. I salute you, and I know people respect that also. So now let's talk about what you feel would bring people's interest in farming, and how could you get additional support? Like, how could the community support you in this initiative on the South Side in IBSE?
Yes, indeed. Most definitely appreciate that question. It's a beautiful question. One thing that got me inspired to answer the first question too is knowledge. Me getting more educated into who I am and what I am, and what's my makeup. Once I learned that our DNA has a certain diet, that then ignited me into, okay, so what's my diet? Not many people have that thought. We're not really in an environment to give us a thought in that manner. And so me learning more Black history, it inspired me. My first turnover into getting into active work was being into so many books and knowledge and having so much to say about these topics that we have issues with. And it just turned the leaf in me to say, hey, I'm kind of practicing being a man of my word, and this is the challenge that I'm taking upon, something that people haven't taught me, but I want to be that way. And so everything that I ever wanted to fight for and believe in is what I'm putting action into. That's why I'm a man of my word today. And so that's what makes me the difference of who I used to be and why I'm doing this. And so with the projects I'm doing with gardening, I'm right now developing a youth community garden with Help in Economics, homeschool curriculum. I believe in, that's the reason why I created Booker T. Washington Holiday, is to, he influenced me to create a curriculum or education to educate is what he call it, you know, and so I want to do a hands-on education, and as well, it'll empower them to be entrepreneurs with that education. And so that's one of my biggest passions into the future of gardening, is to get more children involved. And I think one of my good techniques could be reaching out to the teachers in the schools.
Yes.
And the city, getting more programs in that area to where there can be grants and funding that will make it more easier to accessible for that practice to be organized. So to me, that's one of the best approaches to get a faster outcome. And so I think that'll be one of the best ways to get people more involved.
I agree with you. And as you were speaking, I thought of a couple of things. Service learning is something that I haven't heard a lot about, but when I had a charter school and when I was working in the alternative school setting, it was something called service learning. And there may be funding still available for service learning projects, because you're like servicing the community, but you're learning at the same time. Also, as you were talking, I was thinking about where the National Honor Society and a lot of charter schools, but maybe even public schools, they have mandatory community service requirements. So what a great way for them to have a service learning project as part of their community service to earn their NHS credits, National Honor Society credits, or whatever. So, you know, we can talk a little bit more offline so I can give you a little bit more insight on those tidbits. And also, Community service. So those young people who have got in trouble and got that little slap on the hand, you know, what better way than for them to come and work in your garden and help till that ground, and because it's still a hustle, right? Mm-hmm. You got to get up, you got to put your work in, you got to grind to get the work done, and you still feeding your family. That's but right. You're not putting dope and poison in the community. Mm-hmm. Right? That's so that's a flip on keeping the same hustle mentality. Mm-hmm. You just flipping a different product. Right, and they can get in there and put their work in the same way and come out with a positive lesson being around you. We need more men to influence our young men.
Yeah.
And that's what I really, really appreciate about you guys being together. You know, we can talk all day, but we need young men to be influenced by older men. Mm-hmm. And we need young women to be influenced by positive female role models. Mm-hmm. We need that.
Yep.
So let's go to Jasper. Can you add something to that? So I know that Noah talked about his influence and what was going on with him with Park Ridge, but I know that speaking with you, and you were telling me you were a thinker, and I can tell that, you know, you're very analytical and you put a lot of thought into what you do. So can you share some of those thoughts with our listeners?
How honestly, though?
Very honest. Long as you don't curse, you know, we got to get FCC regulations. You can't curse.
Keep
but
it
you
real.
Can be 100. Yeah. That's what black coffee is about. Bring it strong. No sugar, no cream.
I mean, it's kind of a mixture of what everybody else is doing as far as giving returning citizens an opportunity to work and do something that's productive for the community, also teaching individuals how to grow and garden and be self-sustaining. But my thoughts weren't always on the vegetables and the fruits of it. One of my fathers practiced Rastafari, so when we came into gardening, it was a little bit different than your tomatoes, your greens, your peppers, your various strains of cannabis.
Okay.
For different reasons, not just spiritual and religious reasons, but also for medicinal reasons.
Okay.
Nowadays, you know, marijuana is almost completely legal as far as medical and recreational, but as far as some of the herbs that Noah does and makes teas out of, marijuana, and I'm sorry, cannabis has been used for those same things for hundreds of years. And that's more where my focus has been, is to learn how to garden and grow things properly so that I can apply that to that and be self-sustaining with something that I know is going to carry on.
Okay. I appreciate your honesty. So you growing that chronic.
I'm learning. learning how to grow that.
Well, you know, here at Black Coffee, we keep it real. I appreciate you, brother, for being strong and straight up about that. You know, so, hey, if that's what you want to grow and that's what you want to do, I have seen different aspects and heard different pros and cons about the cannabis industry. But one thing I will say is I feel like we need a piece of the pie also.
Sure.
So I hope that your dreams come true and that is cultivated and that you get in on this $1 billion industry that sometimes we get locked out of.
Well, not to cut you short, but it doesn't sound like we're trying to get a piece of the pie. It sounds like we're baking our own pie.
Okay, well then bake the pie.
He has his world-class farm that's going to teach everybody how to be self-sustaining. He's going to teach people how to be self-sustaining. I mean, we're all bakers in our own aspect. Mm-hmm. A slice of pie is not going to get me full.
Okay.
We
you're going to have your whole pie. I like that. I like that. So that is wonderful. Well, we talked about the overall benefits of the community, whether it's medicinal cannabis, whether it's the fruit and vegetable aspect of it. economic empowerment, economic development, and also talking about the benefits of just having a garden within the community for people. I want to know, what were some of your roadblocks? Did you have any roadblocks? So let's start back with you, Jasper. What were some of your roadblocks when you thought about putting together a community garden? What were some of your roadblocks? Did you have any with the city, naysayers,
Glad you mentioned city first, because that was the first thing that came to my mind, politics. The south side of Ipsy has been changing over the last 30 years. And I mean, the biggest thing that we ran into was politics. I'm not a politician. I don't understand it. When it comes to gardening, the simple things that we needed, we asked for, we received. When those politicians and grant writers and board directors and people with letters in front of their names and commas and behind their names started getting involved, stuff started getting slowed down. You know, it took us weeks or days or, you know, it wasn't right when the politics got involved. As far as I could tell, that was pretty much my only roadblock. Aside from my own personal roadblocks, just not having the time that I'd like to spend in the garden all the time. For instance, I had a couple extra hours a day and stopped by the garden and got my hands dirty. I'm in loafers and a tie.
In those clothes.
Yeah,
you don't look dirty.
I saw him out there.
So you really mastered your process. I don't see any dirt on you, brother.
It's still, I don't have the time that I want and I need to be in that garden, because we were out there this past weekend and we put in a couple hours. We needed to put in a couple more hours today, tomorrow, the next day.
This is your season. This is your season.
So we're in the greenhouse together now.
So I appreciate your perspective and again value your honesty. Noah, what were your roadblocks in this process? Despite, the politicians and all of the things that Jasper pointed out, what did you encounter?
I really was going through a spiritual growth and a transition in my life when this came about. So I was very inspired by Dr. Sabi. And following him for a few years, it was really, it really grew on me, the thought of, his nutritionalist and all the things I was starting to tradition myself into and culture myself into as a black person. I was starting to get into an alkaline diet, get more information into, nutrition. And so I started rocking with Dr. Sabi, early on, before a lot of people got popular with him. And it got me really motivated into growing food. And once Dr. Sabi had passed, I ended up growing my first food, which was an avocado seed in the winter. He passed right before the winter in the fall. And so I started me avocado seed in the window, and it grew into a plant.
Oh, wow.
And I never knew avocado seed can grow in Michigan, so I called it Dr. Sabi, and I've been growing food ever since Dr. Sabi passed.
That's really cool. I've heard a lot about Dr. Sabi, and I have to do a little bit more research.
I'm gonna ask you a question too, but the roadblocks is more like strings attached. I would tell people the survival of doing anything in the community and needing any type of help is to go towards a source that has no strings attached. Go through something genuine. Go through an energy that's more passionate about what you're doing as you are, even if they now have that same vision.
Mm-hmm.
They can feel the passion in you and say, hey, I might not even go to your event, but look, I love what you're doing. I don't have time to do it with you, but here go what you need to support you.
Mm-hmm.
That's what we need. We don't need somebody to say, hey, I can fund you, but you can't do this and you can't do that.
Right.
That is oppressive.
Okay. I got you. So, hey, you want some non-restricted funding, give us the money, let us, and the support, and let us do what we do.
Politics.
And not, yeah, have all these politics and constraints or whatever, and I get that. I get that. So, Melvin, what can you add to this conversation about Roblox?
Roblox. Yeah, just to kind of piggyback on what Jasper and Noah talked about, those are very real and tangible roadblocks that we face in our community. Sometimes, and there's a myriad of reasons why, right? It could be because we're men of color. It could be because there's just simply a lack of resources and opportunities, resources in our community. By the time, I mean, Washtenaw County is probably one of the most resourceful counties in Michigan.
Mm-hmm.
But by the time all of those monetary resources trickle down, right,
to the south side of Ipsy,
right? You know, like there's very little left yet. And, but with that being said, there's over 2,000 nonprofit organizations in Washtenaw County.
Wow.
Right.
That's which staggering.
Which is insane, given the fact that nothing really changes.
Okay,
that's a whole show right there.
Right, in our community, in fact.
We're not going to name names, though, right?
No, we're not going to name. I'm not going
to
name
names.
Oh, I would
you love
can.
To. Yeah,
yes,
I would love to.
But, you know, given that, you know, there's all these things. And so there's a lot of challenges. For me as a farmer, an African-American farmer, land access has been challenging from a political arena.
So you're saying you have the vacant lots available, but the politics get in the way for you to use them to grow.
Well, how about that, the River Street project?
It's the zoning and contaminations and different areas that's not available. It's places that you can't even do a hoop house.
Okay.
Yeah.
I got that. So we're going to go for a break at this moment. And when we come back, we will have a little bit more dialogue with my dear, what I'm going to call my friends, but they were my brothers too, Melvin, Jasper, and Noah. And these are our black farmers. So stay tuned.
And we're honored to be here.
Yes, I'm happy to have you here.
punishment.
So thank you for tuning in to 88.1 FM WHPR. You are listening to the Black Coffee No Sugar, No Cream Show, Straight Talk with Valerie. And we have what we call our community gardeners, but I like to call them black farmers. So I hope that is not offensive to anyone, but I love that term, strong, black, and proud, bringing produce and foods and cannabis and everything to the community. I respect that. I appreciate your honesty. I appreciate the time that we've had together. Unfortunately, our time is about to end shortly, so I will have you guys back when harvest time comes so we can continue this conversation. But as we prepare to close, what would you say is needed to make our communities consistent growing stations? We talked about all of the politics and things of that nature that get in the way. We talked about having some of the grant money, et cetera, funnel down to the south side of Ypsilanti or maybe other areas in Detroit for or other communities that are listening. But does that mean rallying more people to support? Does that mean getting a petition going? What does that look like? How would you want to be supported to make this process more consistent and less bureaucratic and all of this red tape? Let's start with Melvin. I was getting ready to go over here to Jasper. He was like over there. So we'll start here. We have about 4 minutes, so we'll get out as much as we possibly can.
Sure. Just right quick. I've been really fortunate in these last couple of years to get connected to and be surrounded by some really valuable community partners such as Washtenaw United Way, Zingerman's and Cultivate and St. Joe's Mercy of Ann Arbor Hospital, and most recently the Henry Ford. And one of the things that a couple of these organizations, three of them, all of them really have done is like they put their money where their mouth is, right?
Okay.
And that's kind of huge. Because money's a modality, and any work that you do is just important that's there. Now, as it relates to a community and galvanizing a community to make instead, you know, and instead of taking that grass and putting some food there where their home is or something like that, I think that comes down to like education and being informed and supporting them in decisions that empower. Mm-hmm. You know, I think what happens over time in communities that lack those resources and opportunities for so long, they lose the ability to make those choices that empower them.
Mm-hmm.
And so and figure out a way to support them, whether that's individually or as a whole or groups or small pockets of people, figuring out a way to support them and nudging them sometimes in making those decisions that empower them is essential.
I appreciate that because we've all heard that adage, you know, we perish for lack of knowledge. So I love the fact that you have incorporated this educational piece in with what you're doing, the economic development piece, and looking at a cross section of ways to garden.
Mm-hmm.
You know, all aspects from the cannabis to the herbs, healing herbs. So not just from the nutritional standpoint of us eating, but like you said, Dr. Sabe, you know, holistic. He was big on that holistic health, and, you know, so certain herbs and teas and things of that nature. So that is really cool. Thank you, thank you, thank you so much for being on the show today. I thank you from the bottom of my heart. And when I say our, that means my producer, Trishe Duckworth, and myself.
Thank you, Trishe.
And
big shout outs to Trishe.
So they're shouting out to you, Trishe. Thank you so much. We will definitely have to continue this conversation. I would like to learn more about the Booker T. Washington Book Day and any other initiatives. So we're going to close out. As I always do, thank everyone for listening today. And again, I'm paying homage to my father. I didn't know that my father was going to transition on yesterday. However, one thing my dad did was make sure we could provide for ourselves, stand on our own, and make sure we could eat. So, you know, what a great way to have these three strong brothers in the studio with me today. That is about economic development, empowerment, and making sure that we eat and have what we need in our community. Black coffee, no sugar, no cream. We're not about spilling the tea. And I'm not about making you feel dazed like you had a cheap shot of liquor. Mm-hmm. I just want you to feel, think, and view things from my point of view. Mm-hmm. Have a good night. All right.